Welcome, welcome this morning to HCC. My name is Bethany, and we just want to take a minute to say we are excited to see each and every one of you, especially if you are a guest, if this is your first time. We just want to connect with you. We hope you feel welcomed. If you want to connect with us, then we want to connect with you. So we have two different ways that you can do that. You can get out your phone right now, and you can text 94,000, all capitals letters, to the, I think it says HCC Life. Last service, I accidentally said HCC New, so it's HCC Life, 94,000. Also, you can, there's a Connect card in the seat in front of you, and you can fill that out if you don't have your phone with you, and take it to the Welcome Center. If you're joining us online, hey, grab your phone, put a text message out there. We want to connect with you too. Also, if you have your phone out, go ahead and share this message. We want to get it out to the community. First service was absolutely amazing. So welcome. We're excited to see everybody. And we are about ready to dive back into some worship. We're going to sing a song about being brave, about how he makes a way for all of us. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We're thankful for the cross this morning, Lord. We're thankful for our journeys this morning, Lord, and for your goodness. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together.
Let's sing. Anybody here this morning forgiven? Oh, we thank you that we're forgiven. He paid the price that you could be free this morning and your sins are wiped away. This morning I feel that some of you have come in this place and you feel so heavy and bogged down by the chains of the shame and guilt, and you don't even know what to do. People don't even know how bogged down you are, but you've come here this morning for whatever reason. And this morning, I promise you that the chains you came in with are not going to be the chains that you leave with this morning. There is power in the blood of Jesus. And we believe that there is forgiveness and that there is no place for shame and guilt. I'm going to read a Bible verse this morning out of Colossians. This is in Colossians chapter 1, verse 10 through 14. So that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of His holy people in the kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He's brought you and me from the darkness of light into the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. And so when we're singing this song, if we really truly believe that, we wouldn't just be sitting here looking at the words, looking at the screen. Oh, the lights are pretty. The lights are pretty. We wouldn't just be sitting here. But no, I said it like this in the first service. Imagine you just committed a crime. You just committed a crime. You stood in front of the judge. And the judge says, you get life in prison without the possibility of parole. Well, you would have a feeling of hopelessness, a feeling of despair. But then you're walking away and you're ready to go. Life in prison. That's the punishment. But another judge steps in and says, wait a minute, judge. I took the price. I paid the price for those debts. He don't have to spend 1 ounce in prison. He's free. So this morning, if you come in with those chains, the altar workers, can you come forward at this time? But there is power in forgiveness. He's forgiven you, but have you received it? Have you believed it? You need to shift your mind this morning to understand that if you've confessed Christ as Lord, you are forgiven. Your sins are wiped away. Amen. Come on, let's give it up this morning. Oh, it cannot be erased. It cannot be undone. This is your final word for me. Sing it out this morning. It cannot be undone. This is your final word to me. And I'll be. Oh, you cannot. It cannot be all across this place. It cannot be undone. This is your final word to me. And I'll be leaving. Word is written, forgiven, forgiven on my heart. This word is written, forgiven, forgiven. No guilt or shame. I'm covered by your mercy. On my heart, this word is written, forgiven, forgiven. Come on, say forgiven. Everybody say forgiven. Forgiven. We are forgiven. This morning, if you're not only feeling or dealing with shame or guilt, or if you have a physical ailment or something, you just need God to meet your need this morning. I encourage you to take a step of faith this morning. We have a group of altar workers right now that are praying for even some right now on these altars. But there's more of you this morning that need prayer. So right now, I just encourage you, take that step of faith. And let God meet your need this morning. So come down to these altars and get prayed for. Moments. If you need prayer, I just encourage you to come forward. Those are still getting ministered to in the altar. I just want to take this moment and seal this time up with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, thank you, Lord, that you've taken us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Thank you, Lord, that I didn't have to do anything to earn. I didn't have to do anything, Lord, for forgiveness of sins, but you paid the price. I am not worthy this morning, but I give you all of the thanks and the honor, Lord. I pray for those that have come in this morning with heavy hearts and chains of bondage and chains of shame. I pray right now, Lord, that you would intervene in that situation, Lord. Who the Son sets free is free indeed, Lord. And we believe that this morning. And we are just so thankful, Lord, that we stand forgiven. Lord, in the name of Jesus, have your way this morning. And everybody said, one more time, let's sing. All my heart is free. Forgiven, all my heart, this word is written. Forgiven, forgiven, no guilt or shame can hold me. I'm covered by your mercy. All my heart, this word is written. Forgiven, forgiven.
Brandon, I want to rest right here, Brandon. I want to rest right here in this space, in this atmosphere, in this presence right now. And as we think about the worship that just went forth, and we think about the forgiveness that God has granted us, oh, what a beautiful, beautiful space to live in. A space of forgiveness, a space of freedom. I was sitting over here behind the pastor and his family. And I just want to share something that I witnessed and something that God spoke to my heart in that moment. I was sitting behind the pastor and his family, and I saw him look at his daughter. And as a father, as a parent, you know, you recognize that look that you give your child when you see something going on. But what I saw was she received the word, not immediately, but she received the word, and shortly after she went and hugged her father. And in return, he hugged her back. And that embrace was so beautiful because she walked away smiling. And the smile that was on her face reminded me that as we run to the Father, He'll embrace us. He'll wrap His arms around us. He'll love you, and you'll never leave His presence without a smile on your face. That's encouraging to me. That really blessed my heart, because I think about, you know, worship is a beautiful atmosphere. It's a beautiful space. And as the song was sung today, and he talked about God calls us to be brave, and He makes us brave, and He calls us from the shores out into the waves. And for me, that out into the waves can be a scary place because I can't swim. But to be confident and put your trust in Jesus, knowing that you're okay, knowing that He has you and you're not going to drown, you shall live and not die, that gives you a total place of freedom and rest and confidence. And you move different. You live different. You have a different perspective on life. And so right now, we have an opportunity to know that we serve a God who loves us, to know that we serve a God who will never forsake you. And so our response, no, we can't pay Him. You know, we're about to start talking about money, right? But this is not because we want to pay God for what He's done, because God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. He loves us. He loves you so much that He gave His Son for you. So our return is, our response is, not because, but since I love God, since I love the Lord, I'm going to do what's a reasonable service and give as He has given unto me. So I want to share a scripture with you. I want to share some Bible truth with you. I want to share the gospel with you. In Luke chapter 6, verse 38, it says, "Give, and it shall be given unto you, in good measure, pressed down and shaken together, and running over, shall you give into your bosoms, for with the same measure that ye have given, withal it shall be measured unto you again." So as we believe God's word, as we believe God's truth, we now can walk in confidence knowing that we don't have to fear. We can trust Him with our finances. We can trust Him with our time, our talents, our treasures, because our sustainability, sometimes we feel like it's tied to our finances. Well, if I do this, I don't know if I'm going to be okay over here. But as we know and we have the confidence that our sustainability comes from Him, we can with confidence give, knowing that God is going to take care of us. So we want to give you some options today. If you're with us online, you can go to our website, hcconline.org. You can give that way. Or if you have your phones and you're here with us in the sanctuary, you can text HCCGive to 94000. And also in the house, we have buckets that the ushers will direct you to. But we want to bless you as you give today. We want to pray over the offering so that God can have His way in your life. Let us look to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You, God, for the freedom in Your forgiveness, God. We thank You, Lord, because You love us so much that we have an opportunity to give, that You protect us, You bless us, You sustain us, You keep us covered, God. So we just thank You, God, for an opportunity to participate, to be the hands and feet in Jesus, to operate in a way that You get the glory in everything we do. God, bless those who have a desire to give. God, we ask that You bless their gift, whatever it may be. God, we thank You for their intentionality. We thank You for their dedication. Some came today, already made up in their mind what they're going to give. So God, we bless You for that. We thank You for that. And God, we ask that You have Your way. We know Your word never goes out and returns void. So God, we give You all the praise, honor, and glory. And we ask these blessings in Jesus' name. God bless you as you give.
Good afternoon, everybody. Are you here? Awesome. Sweet. That helps. I appreciate you very, very much. We're going to do some in-house thing right here that's very important to us. Our governance body consists of the Board of Elders, the Board of Trustees, and we also have a deacons group. And in the first service, we installed and had an oath of office for a new elder. And now we are going to ask our deacons, you should know who you are, to come forward at this time and stand right here in front of me for this couple minutes that we're going to have together. So if you could stand up and walk forward. And then I'm going to ask any existing elders or trustees, if you could come in and get behind these individuals for us real quick and just stand behind them in proxy as we have them go about this oath. So if, again, you could have them, that would be awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yes. And then our church, Chance, who's on our staff, the deacons report to him. Ladies, good to see you. So glad. Thank you so much. So you're going to have three responses, okay? You're going to have two I haves and an I do. Kind of feels like you're marrying the church. All right, sounds good. Here we go. Have you prayerfully considered the qualifications and principles of the administrative leadership set forth in the New Testament? So far, so good. Only got two more. Have you carefully considered the duties of the office of a deacon set forth in the Church Revised Code of Regulations and His Word? Do you accept the office of deacon of HCC and pledge to faithfully endeavor to discharge the duties thereof so as to promote well-being of the church according to the rules of order and the Word of God? Yeah. Inasmuch as you have been duly recommended by the pastor, confirmed by these elders and trustees, and appointed by the Board of Trustees in this church body, and have accepted this appointment with sincerity and have pledged before these people to faithfully discharge the duties of this office, you are now by the laying on of hands with earnest prayer and formally installed to the office of deacon on this Sunday, the 7th of March, 2021. I ask that you stretch your hands this way as we pray and install these deacons for the next 3 years. Father God, I thank you so much. I thank you, God, for Pam. I thank you for Susan. I thank you for Christy. I thank you for their yes, Lord, as they've already been serving in this capacity. Today we publicly recognize them, but you in private, Lord, have recognized, called them, drawn them out to serve in such a way as this. We thank you for your yes unto us, and I thank you for their yes unto you and unto this office of deacon. Lord, we ask you, anoint them, bless them, go before them, and help them, God, to be ministering unto you and to those who might be in need to be able to serve the mission and the vision of this house. We give you praise and glory for all of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Love you guys very much. Let's give it up for Jesus. Thank you. They do an incredible job when we are having funerals. That's many of the ways that they will support us. There's so many things that go on outside of Sunday that many may not know. And that's one of those things that is so crucial for anybody who's lost someone and they've chose to have that at the church. I am very honored to be a part of this team when we do funerals. This team does an amazing job loving families and supporting them in those moments. So that's one of the many things that deacons do, and they do it very, very well. In case you didn't know, we are in the month of March, and I'm sure you've been sensing and feeling that the season's turning. It's getting a little warmer. I think today the weather's a little bit of a lie, though. I got to be honest. I looked outside, and I was like, yeah, and then I stepped outside. Still felt like winter. Looked like spring, felt like winter. That's the season we're in, because it's not exactly spring yet. But hold on, I heard this week we're going to see 70. Woo. Mm. Bring on the shorts and the white legs. So that's what's going to happen, I can tell you that right now. Yep. This month, I am preparing our hearts as we move into Easter. Many, mostly more Orthodox, will be in the midst of Lent right now. And maybe some of you are still honoring that. I think it's beautiful if you do. We have mentioned it before. We've taught on it before, but we don't practice it yearly. But I know that's something that's incredible, to be able to fast or put something aside for the purpose of spiritual gain. It's biblical and appropriate. And for me, though, I want to take this whole month and teach seven things about the cross. This original sermon, I've now taken a sermon that someone preached and I've spread it into 4 weeks. That's called being long-winded, in case you didn't know that, okay? So that's just part of the journey. But I was inspired by a message by Robert Morris that he preached online. You know, it's been a year since we pretty much said, we're not having church. It's been a year now, and I'll tell you, this is a lot better. Preaching to people and not staring at a camera. This is way better. And he preached this sermon. It was titled The Seven Truths of Easter, and I'm titling it The Seven Truths of the Cross. And it'd probably be even more appropriate to say The Seven Truths from the Cross. These are the seven things that while Jesus was hanging on the cross, he spoke. And this is important. You know, final words are crucial. Sending off. You know, they tell you when you make a speech, your beginning and end is about the, they don't know anybody listening to anything in the middle, right? Well, we know with Jesus, we're intent with everything that we have that he did, but how important are his final words? There are seven things within hours of his death while hanging on the cross, Jesus spoke, and they are crucial for your life. They're crucial for our understanding of who he is, what he did, our salvation, the purpose of this season that we celebrate, of his death on a cross and 3 days later coming out of that grave. These seven truths we need to understand and embody and embrace and practice in our lives. So the seven truths of the cross, I want to read them to you now. Maybe you're taking notes just to get them in your spirit, but I am not going to teach or preach all seven of these today. We're going to grab two today. We're going to grab two next week. We're going to grab two the third week. And then we're going to grab the last one on Palm Sunday. But here they are. The first one is total forgiveness. The second one is immediate paradise. The third one is never forsaken. These sound good, don't they? The fourth one is constant care. The fifth one is full atonement. The sixth one is completely finished. And the seventh one is eternal commitment. I'm hoping this is kind of like a waiter coming up to your table and reading the menu to you. You're sitting there like, oh, I can't wait. Did that happen? Darn. Hoping it would. So be prepared. I don't want you to miss a week this month. Of the seven truths that I'm speaking of, there's three of these phrases or statements. What we've done, these are words of Christ from the cross, and we've summarized it into 2 to 3 words per point. The first three that we see come from the book of Luke. There are three that come from the book of John. And there's a seventh that both Matthew and Mark share the phrase in their writings. So let's jump into number one. Number one is total forgiveness. This is found in Luke chapter 23, verses 33 and 34. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him. And the criminals, we're going to get back to these criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. And Jesus said these words, these amazing words, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And it said they went on to divide his garments and cast lots. I don't know if you know this or not, but this is a prayer. In pain and in agony, Jesus prays unto the Father and says these words, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. For me, this is deep. And this is at least two things. For one, it's an opportunity for us to receive this most amazing mercy and grace. For Jesus to say, I don't even know what I'm doing sometimes is amazing mercy and grace. Now, there's been times I've known what I've done and I've still done it, and it was wrong. But for him to have a thought towards me like that, he's depraved, he was fallen, he didn't know what he was doing. Now, I'm not saying you can't grow into an awareness to know what you're doing, yet still do it. And I see another part of this where can we get to a point in our walk where we don't take it so wounded to the inside that we are in a place like Christ, who could have taken it differently. Now, here's the difference between you and Jesus. He was born differently. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit. He was human in flesh, but God of the Spirit. He had flesh wrapped around the Spirit of God. He was God in the flesh. He did not sin, was not going to sin. So even from that cross, he said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." How difficult is that for us? Yet it's okay and appropriate for us to ask of the Spirit to help us to have a perception the same way Jesus did. That when someone hurts us, wounds us, could we be in a place where we would say, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." This word forgive is more than what meets the eye. It is to permit. It's to allow. And specifically, I want you to look at a word here. It's not to hinder. I'm drawn to a scripture because it's so appropriate to balance scripture with scripture. I'm drawn to another book, another gospel book, the book of Mark, where Jesus is teaching. And his disciples were normally within earshot of him, and there were some kids being loud and wanting to go sit on Jesus' lap and hang out with Jesus. And they're like, "Shh, shut those kids up. Jesus is saying some really important stuff. You gotta keep the kids quiet." And Jesus knew it. So contextually, I'm about to show you that he was specifically talking in this moment about little people. Because that's what a kid is, by the way, if you didn't know that. It's a human being that's not fully grown yet. I know that sounds crazy, but you need to be aware of that, because sometimes we treat them like they're not human. Right? They were where you were before. You are what you are now. Okay? So Jesus is recognized that's a spirit, that's a soul, that's a body. And what does he say about that? Mark 10:14. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Let me tie this back together. Yes, it's appropriate for us to speak specifically about kids, but that's not what I'm talking about so much here. The big principle, the universal truth is Jesus desires that none of us, or religion, or anything, hinder people from getting to him. That's what we need to take from this. That what he did on the cross is total forgiveness, and we need a proper perspective of Scripture that God's desire is that there's no hindrance between you and him. That's why he sent Jesus to the cross. That's why he was willingly going to the cross. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise," as some understand slowness. "Instead, he is patient with you." Why is he patient with you? Why is he patient with your neighbor? Why is he patient with your kid? Why? Because he loves them. And he doesn't want anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. People always want to know, well, will everybody get an opportunity? According to the scripture, yes. Because God's not a liar. And if he has a desire, which he has a soul, so he has a mind, will, and emotion, if God's desire is for all to come to repentance, then we have to trust that all will have a chance to come to repentance. So trust the Holy Spirit. As you pray and intercede for that individual, trust that according to his word, they will get an offer. They'll get an offer. They'll get an opportunity. There's an opportunity coming just within weeks, and I want you to make you mindful of this. We have little Easter invite cards. If you haven't seen those before you leave, please grab a handful. Don't grab 100 of them if you ain't going to pass out 100 of them. Be good stewards. Grab a few and then grab a few next week. But take them with you. And I told the first service this, listen, if you don't tip 20%, then do not tip after lunch today with one of those cards and it not be 20%. Your pastor told you. If it's anything under 20%, don't give me an Easter card because I don't want to have our name attached to it, okay? Y'all laughing. I'm telling the truth right now.
Well, he didn't do good.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, right? Because you're always on your A game, right? So, what am I saying? Grab some of these cards. This is an opportunity. People think about church. They think about coming to church. Wearing a pretty hat, maybe. Wearing a nice outfit. It's Easter. Leverage this opportunity for someone to come. I can tell you right now, we're going to pour prayer, intentionality, and excellence into that weekend, all three services. It's going to be testimonially driven. It's going to be powerful. And there's going to be a strong invitation for people to come to know Jesus. There's another term in Brandon, I promised him and I didn't talk before service. He knew the content of the sermon and he appropriately picked an amazing third song that prepared this message today. But when he talked about the courtroom, he had no idea I was going to talk about guilt. And how in the Greek we see this word forgive has even deeper meaning. And it's the removal of guilt. But it's the removal of guilt in twofold. The first being this. He's actually removed the offense of your sin. The action of your sin. And the second thing, he's removed the emotion and the feeling that's attached to your guilt. Both have been removed because of the cross. Because of what when he says total, and when he said it is finished, total forgiveness. But that. Too many buts, right? Too much in the way. Total forgiveness. Psalms 103, 11 and 12, so amazing and so poetically says, "For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." This would have been written anything in the first 29 books of Psalm was written earlier than 5th century B.C. Anything after the 29th chapter, scholars are saying, was probably earlier up to 1st, 2nd century, 200 to 300 years before Christ came onto the scene in physical form. Now, I'm going to give you something significant here because I think it's really cool. I call this Fun Facts with PC. Okay? Pythagoras was an astronomer, let's try to say that right, who discovered and had a theory in 500 century, so 500 years, so 5th century BC. It was confirmed with measurements by Aristotle in about 3rd century, so about 350 BC. So for me, this scripture, I can't attach a timing to say that the psalmist David, inspired of the Holy Spirit, confirmed a scientific fact before scientists or astronomers did. But it's in the same time frame. And why am I saying this? Because this, when the Bible says that it's as far as the east is from the west, I'm going to give you a fun fact with me, that knowing that the earth is not flat, I'm sorry to tell you, for all you that are watching those YouTube videos, stop. The circular world that we have, the earth, okay? If I were to be in the South Pole and I were to start going due north, I'm eventually going to go what direction? You guys are genius. South. But listen to this. Why did the Bible say, this is so powerful, why did it say as far as the east is from the west? Now, it would say if a flat earth, that makes sense. I just keep going away from each other. Sure, you can go with that. But I like this. If I go east, I will always go east. I keep going east. If I go west, I will go west. And I can never say that I'll go east. It's infinity. It's total forgiveness. God is not intentional that we might reverse direction. When he says, I've forgiven you, that's what he means. And that's why his word says it's as far as the east is from the west. But let me give you a couple more fun facts. Isaiah 40, 22, look it up on your own. Isaiah said, the prophet Isaiah said, the circle of the earth, and guess when that was written? 6th century B.C. Over 100 years before any astronomer had a theory about the circle of the earth. And let me throw you out another one. Job talked about how the heaven circles about the earth. And that was written in 7th century B.C. So there are some fun facts for you. God forgiving us can also be known as we use this understanding of the courtroom is this word, justified. Known as within the, when we talk about doctrine, justification. Where do we get this from? There's multiple scriptures, but I want to show you one. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, having been justified by faith. You want peace in your life? Believe his word to be true. Therefore, having been justified by faith, then what follows? About three to five very important words. We have peace with God. How are you going to grow in your faith if you can't finally put your feet on the fact that you have been saved? I've got to move past this concern of whether or not what Christ did for me was good enough or big enough. Whether his blood is great enough. Total forgiveness. And understanding. So let me give you this word real quick. Justified. Three syllables, right? Just if I'd. I think some of you just caught it. Just if I'd never sinned. Receiving God's forgiveness. And we recognizing what he accomplished on the cross. It will empower you not only to walk in truth, recognizing the justification of your sin and the redemption of your life, but it will give you a proper perspective and a platform to forgive others who have hurt you. I want to share a story with you that is so powerful. Corey, it's C-O-R-R-I-E, 10, T-E-N. Boom is the name. What a great last name, by the way. Boom. She was not a Jew, but she helped hide Jews from Nazis and was found, her and her sister doing it. So what did they do? They imprisoned her in a concentration camp with Jews. Listen to this story. She survived it. They came and got and rescued her before she died, but she was on her way to death, starvation. She became an evangelist and preached the gospel. And in 1947, while in a church, this is what happened. It was in a church in Munich where I was speaking in 1947. And I saw him, a balding, heavy-set man in a gray overcoat. A brown felt hat clutched between his hands. Then one moment I saw the overcoat and a brown hat. And in the next moment I saw the blue uniform, the visored cap with the skull and the crossbones on it. Memories of the concentration camp came back with a rush. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the center of the floor, the shame of walking naked past this man. I could see my sister's frail form ahead of me, ribs sharp beneath the parchment of skin. Betsy and I had been arrested for concealing Jews in our home during the Nazi occupation of Holland. This man had been a guard at Ravensbrück concentration camp where we were sent. Now he was in front of me, hand thrust out. A fine message, Fräulein, miss in German. How good is it to know that, as you say, all our sins are at the bottom of the sea. It was the first time since my release that I had been face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk, he was saying. I was a guard there. But since that time, he went on, I have become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did there. But I would like to hear it from your lips as well, Fräulein. Again, the hand came out. Will you forgive me? And I stood there. I could not do it. Betsy, my sister, had died in that place. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply by asking me a question? It could not have been many seconds. There's no way that I could stand there. It felt like hours. I wrestled with the most difficult thing I'd ever had to do. But I knew that I had to do it. The message that God forgives has a prior condition, that we forgive those who have injured us. If you don't forgive men their trespasses, Jesus said, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. Still, I stood there with coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Jesus, help me, I prayed silently. I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the ability, the feeling. And so, woodenly, mechanically, I thrust my hand into the one stretched out to me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in my shoulder. It raced down my arm, and it sprang into our joined hands. And then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. I said, I forgive you, brother, with all my heart. You see, she went on to say, for a long moment we grasped each other's hands. The former guard and the former prisoner, I had never known God's love so intensely as I did then. Can I say something about this story? This can only be accomplished by the power of the cross. The cross is the only bridge that can take us over the chasm of sin that keeps us from God. My second point and my last point today. Immediate paradise. Luke chapter 23. Verse 43, and Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Paradise, or as we would probably mostly refer to it as, heaven, is mentioned 582 times in the Bible. 327 of those in the Old Testament, 255 in the New Testament. I want to read to you the story of the two thieves, because here's what I need you to understand today. You are one of those thieves. That is the reality of the matter. You're the one that rejects Jesus, or you're the one that respects Jesus and receives him. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, and I want to preface something. If you read your story clearly and very intently, both of these criminals shamed and blasphemed and called out to Jesus with negativity, but one changed his mind. If you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other answered, rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. You need to hear these two words. Today, paradise. Immediate paradise. This moment to me is simply amazing. This thief, this criminal, this sinner, 99.9% of his life, he was in open sin. An enemy to God. When he died, he would be separated from God for all of eternity. But while hanging on that cross alongside of Jesus, he did some things that you must do in order to inherit the kingdom of God. And I want to read them to you. He said these words, do you not even fear God? You understand that this criminal changed his heart. He changed his mind. And he said, this second criminal decided to respect God, to fear God, to recognize that he was right next to him and who he was. He knew his own sin. He said, under the same condemnation, we indeed are justly to be hung on these crosses. We are paying for our sin, but this man has done nothing. Nothing. This man came to realize he knew his wretchedness. He knew his condition. He went on to say, this man has done nothing wrong. Do you know what? He knew who Jesus was. He came to a recognition of who God was. And then he said these five words. He said to Jesus, one simple word, Lord. How significant is that? Well, first, he recognized that he needed to call out to Jesus. But who he understood Jesus to be was crucial. He used the proper word, Lord. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. You see, he recognized that he was a king. He recognized that he had a kingdom. And he knew that he had access to it through him. Do you know that? He believed Jesus was who Jesus said he was. And then what was Jesus' response? Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. He believed the promise of everlasting life that comes from Jesus. Which thief? Which thief? I find it pretty remarkable. This guy wasn't a member of his church. He hadn't done a short-term mission trip. He wasn't serving on a dream team. He wasn't a good steward of his time, talent, and treasure. Yet one day we'll get to see him. Well, I've been a Christian for 40 years, 50 years. He was a Christian for about, I don't know, 10, 15 minutes. God's grace, his mercy is unbelievable. 2 Corinthians 5, 6, 7, and 8 says this, so we are always confident. I didn't hear everybody say this word, confident. Say it with confidence. Say confident. That's better. Knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. The word confident is mentioned in verse 6, mentioned in verse 8, but what keeps that tied together is what's mentioned in verse 7, faith. We have to take him at his word. Hebrews 4 and 16 says this, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This is the difference between you growing in Christ, advancing in Christ. It's confidence, and it's not in you. It's in him. It's in the truth of the gospel. It's in the truth of his word. You can't earn something that you can't earn. You've got to receive it. You've got to rest in it. You've got to trust it. You've got to speak it. When anything counters it, you speak against it with the word of God. When religion says one thing, your word says another thing. So I leave you with this. Why can we be confident? That should not look like pride. That should not look like self-righteousness. Why can we be confident? Is it because we've accomplished something great? Actually, it's because of completely opposite. It's because his word says, I've done nothing. He's done everything. My confidence is in the cross. It is in the one who hung on that cross. Stand with me today. My desire for you as your pastor is by the time this month comes to a close and you walk into Easter service, you have grown in confidence of who he is. That you're not going to toil with the lies of uncertainty when it comes to your salvation. When it comes to what he said about you from that cross. What he says about your life and your eternity from that cross. Will you receive it? Will you trust it? I want to be reminded as we go back into a little bit of worship. Can we receive the word that has been spoken today? And can we just lift up hands? I want everybody in the house to take up some hands. You can go low, man. You can go here. All right? You can go all the way up here. But let's just receive and let's worship together. And then I have a couple of questions for you and prayers for you before you go. Let's worship.
Can I be erased? Can I be undone? This is your final word to me, and I believe it. Can I be erased? Can I be undone? This is your final word to me, and I believe
it. Oh, yes!
Can I be erased?
Come on, let's worship
him.
Ask everybody to close your eyes. You can lower your hands if you want. This is a serious moment. This is an invitation to eternal life. This is a rejection of your will and a surrendering to His desire for you, His thought for you. The Bible says to believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that He is God, that He is Lord, and He's Lord over your will and your desire in your life. And we need to surrender and trust Him. So if you've never received Jesus, I'm going to have you pray a prayer. We want you to take this opportunity. You're not been in a better place than right here, right now. If you're online with us, pray this prayer. And you're going to let us know that you received Him. We want to come alongside of you and help you in this faith journey. So if you're in the house today, you're joining us online, if you could pray with me right now and say these words. Say, "Dear God, through your Son Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I trust you with my life. Today, I receive your forgiveness over my life, over my sin. I trust in you that you died on the cross. 3 days later, you rose again. I accept that. I believe that. And I repent of my ways and my sin. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen." If you just prayed that prayer and you want to tell somebody about it, there's a way to do that. Get your phone out. 94,000, HCC Faith, all caps. We want to know. We want to contact you this week. Touch base with you. Now I'm going to ask for some real boldness right now. If today you know you're saved, but this message, you need the Holy Spirit to help you in your confidence. The enemy and people and religion continue to question your identity and your uncertainties, and it kind of drags you and holds you back from your growth and your relationship. I'm going to ask for some courage. If that's you, are you going to raise your hand right now? I want to pray for you. Father God, let your word not return void, because it doesn't. We are trusting that it has been spoken over the hearts and lives of every person here. Holy Spirit, give us strength. Remind us of your truth. Remind us of your word. Let us recognize that we have total forgiveness. That when we are not fearful of death, we have immediate heaven and paradise awaiting us. Let us walk in that comfort. May we not dwell in our past, in our failures. Let us trust that our identity is in you. Help everybody in this room to gain and grow in the confidence of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Turn your palms up. I just want to bless you before you go. This is a pastoral blessing over your life. Thank you for being here today. Precious God, through your Son Jesus, and the power of your holy, Holy Spirit, thank you for this opportunity today to be reassured of your truth, of your word. God, thank you that we have favor from you and in you, that we don't have to perform for you. Thank you for the gift of salvation. I ask, Lord, that you go before every single person here. Bless them, God. Wherever they go, go before them, God. Protect them. Watch over them. And we thank you, Father, that in your Son, we get to do these three things. We get to know, share together. Amen and amen and amen. Have a blessed day.